There. Welcome to the Ohio Arts Council's Rife Gallery Artist Talk Series for our current show, the 2021 Biennial Juried Exhibition, juried by April Tsunami, Jessamy Jones, and Kevin Lyles. Today we're thrilled to present Eva Kwong, one of our 53 exhibiting artists. But first, there are of course just a few housekeeping items to go over. Everyone tuning in today is listen-only mode today, but that doesn't mean that you have to stay silent. Feel free to utilize the chat or Q&A functions there in your control panel to ask questions. We'll be sure to monitor those questions throughout the presentation and leave plenty of time at the end to answer all of them. Next, live captioning is available for this artist talk, and you can access those captions by clicking on the closed caption icon and selecting show subtitle. Also, please keep in mind that because we are presenting from separate locations, there may be some variation of bandwidth for internet stability. So if one of us freezes up or the sound kind of fluctuates, thank you in advance for bearing with us. I promise we'll keep on rolling through any technical difficulties. And lastly, to get everyone comfortable, go ahead and click on that chat function in your control panel and say hello and let us know where you're tuning in from. Okay, thanks all. And now to you, Eva.
Well, hi, everybody. Thank you for joining me today. I was having some computer problems, so I can't quite see what's going on. I guess I've been an artist my whole life. I was born in Hong Kong, and my parents decided to move to New York when I was 13. So being thrown in a new culture, a new language, new schools, new everything, it was, a big change. And I guess one day, one semester, they put me in an art class. So I put me in the corner, I start drawing. And I thought, well, I can do this. So I decided I wanted to become an artist, not knowing really actually what it all meant. So I went to an art high school, High School of Music and Art in New York City. And from there, I was fortunate to go to Rhode Island School of Design and then on to grad school at Tyler. So, and I've been working in the arts since in one form or another. The first image I'm going to show you is an important work for me. In hindsight, I realize this particular piece contains a lot of the seeds of ideas that I'm still dealing with today. I grew up in dense cities. I come from a large family, and I realized that I'm always kind of one of many and many of one. And so the concept of one of many and many of one starts from, my childhood experience and also looking at the world around me. I realized that we are all the same and yet not the same. We're all human, we're all people, we share, most of our genetic information, but yet, we have slight idiosyncratic expressions in ourselves. Like I don't particularly look like my two sisters, actually the three of us hardly look alike, and yet we grew up in the same household, we have the same parents, and we ate the same food. And we shared the same rooms. So this piece is called Thousand Shells. It's all slip cast porcelain. There were many variations in the next slide. Next slide, please. There were many variations within this object, this piece. Kind of like us, at first glance, we all look alike, but if you look closely, there's slight variations, some a little bit bigger, some a little bit smaller, some's got little extra bumps, and some have a bump over here, some have a bump on the right side, some have a bump on the left side. So I think, this sort of runs through a lot of my work, which you'll see later, like in bacteria, diatoms, and cells, right? Again, each part is unique. They are similar to each other, but they are different. So they're the same, but yet at the same time, not the same. Next slide, please. Or next image. Or next one. So, and this is a part of the Gardens of the Mind series. And I was thinking about, I was looking at miniature painting. I was looking at Japanese sand gardens. And I was also looking at the landscape, the Pennsylvania landscape. That was a particularly cold winter. So everything was covered in white snow. So the whole world was white, white on white, you know. So all the pine trees are the like these white cone shapes. And because it's all covered with white snow, there's this beautiful sense of light that glows from the snow. So that's how these pieces came about. They're small, so you see it all at once, and that you enter into it like a miniature painting. You enter into this miniature world that is bigger than its physical size. Next, please. So they're kind of about relationships between the forms. And I guess it's echoed by my interest in relationship between things as well as between people. Next, please. And I think growing up in two cultures and speaking two languages, I always, I have affinity to thinking about what's the other side of it, to think of things in many different ways. So part of this Garden of the Mind series became kind of more two-dimensional. So these are painted glazes on porcelain slabs. So I wanted to kind of embed a sense of light rather than relying on exterior light like in the other pieces, but a sense of kind of embedded light within the piece through the use of color and shapes. Next, please. And let's see. I have to catch up. In 1980, my late husband, Kirk Mangus, and I, we built a wood kiln, and we used dug a lot of our natural clay near where we are. And so I was interested in using the colors from the different kinds of clay that we find, the different kinds of clay that we use, and the different ways that we can fire with them. Next, please. So this interest in the egg and this interest in the moon and circular forms, you will see also repeated throughout my work. And a lot of natural clay, you know, in the evening, we would sit and sort through all the natural clay that we dig up and pick out the bits of rocks and roots and stuff. And I start collecting these rocks and I start embedding them back into the pieces, like in this piece. Okay, next, please. So for the larger things, I coil built. And so this is 1983. I was thinking of these as kind of like torsos, or kind of like cocoons, kind of like mummies, and kind of like eggs. And the start leads to, and I was thinking about having some children. So I was thinking about genetics and how we pass on, what we pass on to our next generation. So I started a series called Fertility Series. And also, you know, it's got me thinking about my own heritage and my own genetic background, looking at my parents, looking at my siblings, looking at my grandmother. So, and these pieces are, next please, or made of local clay and that we dug up and it was fired in our wood kiln that we made. So this piece is a good example of what happens in a wood kiln. The peach on the left is on a high spot in the firing, so it has a lot of ash deposits. So it's all, the coloration comes from the interaction of the clay with the firing process. And the pear shape in the right side is on the lowest spot, it's on the floor, so it has a lot of the charcoal colors. And I've embedded some pink silicon carbide for the pink spots, and I embedded a quartz rock on the piece. Next. And so these small pieces were solid because I used to fire between 9 and 10 days in my wood kiln, so it takes a long time. And so I can fire very thick things. And the larger things, like the next piece, next please, are the larger things are coil built. And again, the coloration comes from the interaction of the clay and the firing itself. Next. So these are all pieces that are made between 1980 and 85. So this was an installation I did in Pittsburgh with all these pieces. It's sort of based upon my body or parts of my body. Next, please. This was a large slab I made for an Enseca conference. It was, I think that conference was, the theme was architecture. And I was interested in the old tablets from the Middle East and the cuneiform writing tablets and how they're embedded with information. So even though we don't exactly know how to read it verbally to kind of, but we still see the embedded information on it. And I was interested in the mark of the hand. So this whole slab was covered with my handprint. It's also how I made it. It's part of the process of packing the clay together. Next. So 82, I was teaching in Cleveland. So I went back to working with porcelain. So these are all high temperature because all my glazes at that time were high temperature cone 6, once fired reduction glazes. And I was also coil building. So this is pieces about, I think, 42 inches high. And next, and working with, again, with the colors of high temp reduction. Next. After I left school, I realized I missed some of the community, and the things I missed is that I realized I have to provide for myself. I have to be my own teacher. I have to be my own student. I have to be my own janitor. I had to do everything for myself, and which included giving myself assignments. So I make it a point every year to learn something new or to do something that I've never done before. And so sometimes there's lead to kind of long-term projects. Sometimes they're very short-term. Sometimes they're more successful than others, but generally it leads to something else. So all my old, we go back one image, please. And on the last image, these were all cone 10 reduction high temperature glazes, and a lot of my glazes had a lot of barium in it. And when I decided to become pregnant, when I got pregnant, I realized I did not want to work with those materials anymore because I can taste it on my tongue, even though no matter how careful or clean I was. So I decided to shift to using slips because they don't powder off like my glazes did. So I started this series. And it's called Opposites Attract series. And I was thinking about the duality within my life. And because of my growing up in two cultures and, you know, getting the genetic inheritance from my father and genetic inheritance from my mother. And then I realized my children will also do that. They'll inherit 50% from me and 50% from their father. So that started this series. And I moved to working with colored slips to get color and also working with salt clay. So a different way of painting colors or getting colors on the surface of the objects. Next. And next. So they're kind of, again, about duality, about two things that go together. Next. And so the pink lakes, I realized I've always been interested in my, you know, in how our body functions. But looking at the bodies of my children, I realized they have a slightly different orientation. They view the world differently because, you know, they're much closer to the ground. And this gesture of reaching out, reaching your hands out, like, hold me, hold me. I realize it's a universal gesture. We all do it. And we all want to reach out to each other. We all want to love someone else, and we all want to be loved by them in return. We also want to be embraced and be embraced. So these sculptures have these legs that come out, or arms, that embrace the space around them. So that's started in the mid-80s. Next. And as I had more time, as my kids grew bigger, I was able to start making larger sculptures again. And so these are coil built, and they paint it with many layers of slips. And sometimes I carve back into them, and they're salt glazed. Next. And again, I think of them, you know, this sort of harks back to the early, you know, the fertile garden that were wood fired in Pittsburgh. And so again, they're parts of the body. And that kind of all go together. They're not identical, but yet they relate to each other. Next. So I kind of treat the slips kind of like paint. I paint on layer after layer after layer. So sometimes they could be 5 layers, could be 10 layers, it could be 15 layers. And I just keep painting till the color looks right. So one of the things, one of the profound experiences I had was when I was an undergrad, I worked at the nature lab for Miss Lawrence, who collected objects from nature. She had thousands of things like fossils, beetles, birds, you know, bones. And my job was to catalog them. So it taught me to look at things in the round, because I had to put a catalog number onto the piece. And I realized in studying and looking at all those things that things in nature, things from nature, is not flat colored. Flat color is a human invention. Everything in nature has nuances. The color shift, even a rock, the color shift from one side to another. If you look at a leaf, the top of the leaf is usually a different color than the bottom of the leaf. So even with us, you know, we have the color of our skin on the top of our hand is different than the color of our skin on the bottom of our hand, and same with different parts of our body. So I like to, with these larger sculptures, because it's a large space, I'm able to paint on many kinds of colors throughout the piece. So the blue on the tip of the leg is different than the blue on the bottom of the leg. The blue on the leg of the right side is different than the blue on the leg on the left side. And the yellows on orange spots on top, again, shifts. So there are many, many different kinds of colors on top. In fact, you can't really count how many colors I have on there. And I also lose count myself, because they are layered over and over again, you know. And also, colors next to each other interact with each other and change the perception of what the colors are. So I was kind of fortunate to start reading and studying color theory since I was in high school. And so I'm always kind of thinking about how color interacts next to each other. Okay, next. So some of my work, most of my work actually comes from some kind of question from my life, either posed by myself and sometimes by my family. And so this was, my kids were asking me like, how do you know, like, why do we have to eat vegetables, you know, what the body? So I'm sort of imagining what these molecules might go through as they're going through the different layers within our body from one section to the next. So it's, this is two layered, and these two molecules are caught between the layers. Next, please. So yellow flow is another one where it's more of a subtractive process instead of add. I layer all the colors on first, And I also think about what might be revealed. Then I come back and carve out all the little bits. So each of the little bits of color is the layer underneath. And sometimes there could be many layers within that little cutout hole or cutout spot. So it's kind of like a sketchbook. So I wanted to kind of embed this kind of sense of complexity on these sculptures, kind of like the complexity that is within our body. We're made out of, you know, billions of cells. And, you know, sometimes if you think about it, it's kind of mind-boggling. We can't possibly count them all. And that's also kind of the sense I want you to get from these pieces, is that there's a sense of energy and movement to them, but there's also a sense of lots of parts that you can't quite count. Next. So again, this is another instance where all the parts kind of relate to each other and each form is different. Next. So this is another version of generations that you see in the previous one. And this was inspired by looking at four generations of women in my family. It happened one day where it was just my grandmother, my mother, myself, and my daughter eating lunch together. And as I look around the table, I realize, oh, we don't look alike, but yet we are related. I have 50% of my mother's blood, and my mother have 50% of her mother's blood, and my daughter have 50% of me, but yet we are not identical. So this started me thinking about how things are passed on from generation to the next. So each of these balls are kind of like an egg where we share similar, the markings are similar, but they're not identical. So as each generation changes, the genetic information changes slightly. And sometimes they may come back full circle, and like sometimes you'll say, oh, you have a nose just like your grandmother, but you don't have the nose of your mother nor your father. Or sometimes it could be something that's passed down verbally, orally, in family history. Like you act just like your grandfather, or you behave like aunt so-and-so. So anyway, so next, please. I guess there have been many pieces, many that I've dealt with mortality and passage of time and passage of life. So I was offered to have this show at Spaces in Cleveland. And this room was a very narrow rectangular room, two short sides and two long sides. And with one door, and I realized it is the same proportion of a old tomb that I saw in Nara, Japan. And it's the same proportions. So I thought about using this Chinese funerary paper. The funerary paper is generally burned at funerals as a conduit of sending messages from our physical world to the spiritual world. So in this, I was thinking about transformation. So if you look closely, the gold paper is basically the silver paper with orange paint underneath. So the orange comes up and makes the silver paint look like gold. So the paper is attached to the wall with temporary adhesive. So this is the beginning of the show. So throughout the show, all the paper would fall down randomly. So it's kind of like how leaves fall in autumn time. And so it talks about the passage of time. It talks about the passage of lives. Thank you. Next, please. Okay, next image, please. Okay, so this is another version of generations on the floor. And that is another version of bacteria, diatoms, and cells. So from the opposites attract series, the small sculptures, I start showing them hanging on walls. But I started showing them as singular objects. Then I realized after a while next, yeah, that they are, that they don't exist by themselves. They don't, or they don't like to exist by themselves, as just as we don't, we can't exist totally by ourselves. They exist in a community. So I start putting them together around the early 90s as groupings. So each one is unique, just like kind of going back to like the thousand shell piece. Each one is unique. They're similar. So they have kind of this simple sibling relationship, but they're not identical. So many of the shapes repeat. I realized after I did a lot of research on bacteria and viruses, that they don't have that great variety of shapes. So I start, I guess, inventing them. So these are what some of them look like. And I read that they are on every surface of our world, inside of us, as well as outside, you know. And at first that seemed kind of frightening. But I guess in a way to kind of conquer my fear of them, I start making them. I grew up, my mother was a germaphobe, and she used to disinfect us. We would get soaked in disinfectant water for hours. So as a little kid, we thought it was great fun because we didn't have to get out the tub. But as an adult, I start reading about it, I realized those are really harsh chemicals. It is the same chemicals that you use to wash a bathroom, your floor, et cetera, et cetera. So I thought, oh, that must not be so good for our skin. Another influence on that was thinking about, I saw a drawing by, let's see, escapes me now. Oh, Billy Wagman. Before he was doing a lot of the dog photos, he did a lot of drawings. I saw a drawing show of his in Pittsburgh, and it was a big piece of paper with a little snake, drawn very simply on there, and down below it said a dangerous snake rendered harmless. So I was thinking about that one night, and I thought, okay, well, I think I'll start making these bacteria. I mean, so that, you know, instead of kind of worrying about them, I would start making them and conquer my fear of them. So this is another version of them. So again, each part is unique. No two are alike. They might look similar, kind of like siblings. And I make, for each installation, I make new parts and I mix it with the old parts. So this is an installation at the Center for Disease Control down in Atlanta, Georgia, Center for Disease Control and Prevention down in Atlanta, Georgia. So there are new parts there as well as old parts. So each one is in many ways site-specific or site-sensitive. So it's dependent upon the wall they give me, the size, proportion, the lighting, and the environment around it. Okay, so this is from the Woman to Watch exhibition. So these are some prints that I did. I was invited to a residency at Cycle Press up in Cleveland. They gave me the keys and they showed me a few things to do, and they say, there you go. So it was a really wonderful experience because I had to learn how to do everything myself. And it led me to this series of work. So they're about the bacteria, and I was thinking of them, how old they are. And in many ways, they've been here longer on this earth than we. So they represent a sense of time and a sense of history. Okay, next. So they're both combining hand-drawn images as well as etchings. Okay, next. So this is another piece I did for the CDC. It's a piece called Swarm. And I had made all these little parts for years, probably I showed them in 1980 at Cranbrook. I was a visiting artist there and I had a little mini show, and I made all these little pieces that I gave away to everybody. But I continued to make them over the years. And so I had hundreds, if not thousands, of them. So when this opportunity came up in 2006, I proposed to show this piece there. They had asked for the other one, bacteria, diatoms, and cells, but I said, I have this parallel piece that I've been interested in doing, but I've never shown it before. I've never put it together, but I have boxes of all these little parts sitting everywhere in my house, underneath my bed, underneath every table. Can we go back to it, please? Just one, yes. So as it turned out, it was actually, this is at the visitor center. So if you look to the left of this, everybody who's visiting the CDC has to come in through those doors, one set of doors, through, you know, security, down this hallway, past this wall, and into their meeting rooms. And every day as I was installing the piece, I see people coming in. And at the end of the day, I see them leaving, passing through this wall again, going back through the security door and going back out into Atlanta. So I realized this piece actually talks about the function of this building, about people getting together and people leaving. So we swarm together when we get together, and we also go back to where we came from, much like many other animals in our world, like fish and birds, etc. Okay, next. So lament also deals with mortality and loss. And I realize, again, this is something that that we are not immune to. Nobody's immune to that. No matter whether we're tall or short, rich or poor, we all encounter loss and mortality. So I started with the title. It's called Lament. And for a long time, for many years, I couldn't figure out how to make it. It came from going to my grandfather's funeral, my father's father. And I realized I did not know him and he did not know me, because he was never interested in talking to his grandchildren. It was always, whenever I stay over at their house, they would say, go talk to your grandmother, don't bother me. Then I realized after he died, there were so many questions I wanted to ask him, and we had lost this opportunity for him to know me as a human being and for me to know him as a human being. So that's how this lament piece started. And it took me probably 8 or 10 years to make it. And then one day, because I didn't know what kind of form it would take, so one day it occurred to me that would be in these large teardrop shapes. So this is one I've done several versions of it. Next, please. So this one is at Kenyon College, and it was a really weird space because this is at the old library. It's kind of almost like a W, this wall. So you enter on, next, go back one, please. Back one, back two, back, yes. So you go back, you come into the space on the left-hand side, like your left screen. And I put up a wall of the funerary papers. I used the silver paper. And next, and as you go around the corner of this kind of W shape, you enter into this center space that's full with the teardrops. And then there's also a column in the middle. It's kind of an odd space. And as next. And as you go back out on the other side, you have another wall of paper. And if you look on the lower right side, right underneath the paper is a small desk. So on both sides of the room, I had two old school desk and a chair and some pencils and directions. I know my family was not very good about dealing with death. So I was thinking, well, maybe there are other people who have the same problem. And there were so many things I wanted to tell my grandfather that I never had an opportunity to. And I thought other people might have the same. So here's an opportunity for you to kind of send a message out. So the instruction was for anybody who come into this space to take a piece of the paper down, write a message to their beloved, something that they wish they could have said to them, and put it back up on the wall. And they were to be anonymous so that you can be free in expressing whatever you want to say. So it was a kind of interesting experiment because I wasn't sure of how much participation people would be interested in doing. But when I went to pick up the show at the end of the month, every piece of paper was filled. So that it was quite, heartwarming and also very poignant. Okay, next. So I'm going to skip a little bit here. I'm going to kind of go back to the 80s, to the Opposites Attract series. So oftentimes I do several versions of a particular series. And so I was invited to a show, a tabletop show, and I thought, well, what would I make? And I said, what would we have there? I said, well, each artist will have a table and some flowers. So I thought, well, maybe I'll make some vases for the flowers. And I had not made vases in a long time. So I thought about the Opposites Attract of putting two disparate shapes together. They have to fit. One side is totally enclosed and the other side is open. So when you see this initially, the open side seems empty, but when you put flowers in, the relationship shifts and the enclosed side seems to be full of air. Anyway, they're about kind of relate again, relationships. So they have to kind of fit together and go together. So they're painted with colored slips, and they're also fired in the salt kiln. Okay, next. So I wanted them to be basically small sculptures, that they would be a small sculpture on the table, whether you put flowers in it or not. Next. And I wanted to kind of break up the surface of the pieces. So I started putting the spots on. And also, I was thinking also at that time about cells and about atoms and all the small things that are part of us. And each, as I paint each spot, I think of it kind of like almost like a calligraphy where it records the gesture of your hand, painting onto the surface of the piece. So each spot is kind of unique. Next. So it records a moment of time. Okay, let's see. So these were made in, okay, back up one more. So these were made in China using their clay and their materials, and also based on things I saw there and things I ate. Next. Okay, so two versions of the same vase, and what you put in there changes kind of the perception or the scale of your sense of the scale of the piece. Next. And I guess I think about, the earlier vases were more kind of side by side. They're more like peer relationship. And these newer pieces are more about up and down, the upper world and the lower world. And I guess I think of them as the spirit world. I've lost many members of my family in recent years. So I think of, our world and their world. Next. So the Immortal Peach series was based on my favorite childhood story, The Monkey King and the Journey to the West. And in the story, the Monkey King tumbles, somersaults up to heaven into the Garden of Immortal Peaches, which becomes ripe once every 1,000 years. So every 1,000 years, all the gods and goddesses get together, have a big party and eat the immortal peaches. So somehow he was able to fool the guards and ate a whole bunch of the peaches. So the gods were very upset at him. But I was thinking of them, the immortal peaches give life to the gods and goddesses, and I was thinking of my grandmother at that time who was getting quite old, and the thought of losing her was terrible. So I started making these peaches and thinking about her, that I would like to give her some immortal peaches because I would like her to live with me forever. So I started making these again. I made a few, you saw in 1980, in the beginning of the lecture. Again, those were made solid, these were made hollow, these are wheel thrown. And these, most of these are either fired in a wood kiln or in a salt kiln, because I like the atmospheric firing and I like the changes of the surface of the, from the surface of, from the effect interaction of the kiln. So much like how a fruit has markings from the sun, from the radiance of the sun, that we also see the change of coloration from the markings from the radiant heat. You can see where it's facing the heat or it's facing away from the heat. Okay, next. Okay, next. So what part gets covered with the ash and what part does not? Next. So I think this is an etching about the five siblings. Next. So I was in China, and I was interested in Western China, in the Xi'an area, where there was this traditional usage of the black and white slip glaze. So I wanted to learn how to do it, and the best way to learn how to do something is to do some. And so these are some images from that and images from what I see around me. And so this is the guy at the restaurant, and this is one of the young ladies that would come in and out periodically to visit. And one day she came in kind of upset because people were asking her questions. And I said, you know, as I, you know, the people want to know who her boyfriend is. And I said, well, you know, as a young woman, you don't have to tell anybody who you're thinking of, what you're thinking about. You have, you know, the privilege or the right to have your own private thoughts. So, and also that there's a history of women having their own language among other women. So using a symbolic language. So each flower is a different thought for Xu Wei. Next, please. So these were inspired by looking at a lotus pond when I visited a friend in Texas, and he said, well, why don't you have a pond in your house? And I said, well, I can't because I don't have such a big piece of land like you do. And plus we have the wrong weather. So I thought, well, I'll make my own pond. So these kind of large bowl shapes are kind of like, I think of them kind of like a pond for contemplation. So they're covered with luster. So they have this brilliance to them and the sense of light when you're looking at them in front of them. Next. So that has a silver luster and this has a ruby luster. So it's a kind of red light to them. Next. So this is a piece called Energy Vibrations. So it's about our neurotransmitters, how things pop on and off, as things communicate within our body. Next. So again, more things that happens within our body. So these are porcelain glaze with luster on top. Next. I was doing a project with Ingenuity Festival in Cleveland, and I made some, and this was the year I made some trophies for them to give out to their donors. So what I thought what distinguishes that year was the H1N1. So they were a little bit surprised, but you know, I thought, well, there's no organism as ingenious as actually bacteria, because they can adapt so well, and also they can count. They have quorum sensing. Next. Okay, these are some other projects I've done in Cleveland. This is for Asia Town there. And each of these sculptures actually was originally designed to go in front of a particular place within the community. I wanted something that was very colorful because it's a very drab community, drab neighborhood. And I wanted some to bring kind of some liveliness to them. I also wanted something where people can sit down, because I see a lot of people walking around with big bags of grocery and there's no amenities on the street. There's no place to sit. So I made these kind of bench-like things so people can sit down for a little while or put their bags down. So this, the dancing cranes are to go in front of the senior citizen building because for their long life and their loyalty to each other. Next. The double fish is again, is an image that occurs in many cultures. It both throughout the world and as well as locally, because we have fish fries every Friday here in Northeast Ohio, and also references a lot of the artwork that is in the Cleveland Museum. Next. So this is Asia Town Blossoms for some of the, in front of the new, at that time, newish development in Asia Town area. Next. And I guess around this time I started thinking about looking at different kinds of animals. So this one's named for my dog and the exuberant kind of energy that he had. And I start also looking at cephalopods like octopuses and squids because of their soft kind of sensuous body and the way they move. And so these are again painted with slip and salt glazed. And thinking of next. Thinking about the different the bits of matter that makes up our world within our body and also outside of our body. Next. So this is a bit, this is an installation called Glow, and it's about kind of bioluminescence and about things that glow in the dark, I guess. So it's all made out of paper and paint. So here's what they look like when it's not so dark. It all fits in my carry-on. This oval piece, I was thinking about how we all came from an egg. And our egg, to me, has so many possibilities. So in many ways, to me, it's kind of a symbol of hope and future possibilities, because we don't know what the egg's going to grow out into. So the eggs are generally wood fired or salt glazed, and then they're supported, by a base. It's kind of like the placenta sort of supports the fetus. Next. I'm interested in dealing with material and how the material interacts. And so in this case, the flashing comes from the painted spots. The paint comes from the flashing within the kiln. Next. So this whole acalophoid series is about all these cephalopods and octopuses and squids and also parts of us. Next. So this is a rosa. This is a sura. And filopodia, and again, filopodias are extensions from cells that reach out to each other. So it's again about reaching out and reaching out to the world. And I started this Between Heaven and Hell series. I was thinking about throughout most of human history, we have always used materials that we find in nature, from clay to wood to metal to fibers to stone. And But in our contemporary culture, for the first time in human history, we have things that are not made by hands anymore, but made by machines. So I started making these kind of three-part sculptures. So something that's man-made or woman-made, in my case, something that is from nature, the stone in the center, and something that is made by machine. So that is a 3D printed sculpture on top. Next. So that's kind of started my inquiry in doing some 3D printed work. It's kind of an on and off series. So this is a mini me that I had myself scanned. And so it's a mini version of me, and I'm holding the symbol for infinity in my hand. And I was also protected by this metal cloak. So under heavy sky, I was dealing with a lot of difficult issues, and I feel like I'm almost choked by them. But she's able to peek her head out. So next. So another version of Between Heaven and Hell. Next. So I wanted to kind of, again, I go back. I wanted to learn something new that I haven't done before. So I started learning to do designing 3D printing, designing on Rhino, and also printing some of these sculptures. Next. So they're kind of connected to all the my interests in microbes and also in cephalopods. Next. Next. So Navel the Universe, it's a form that I've made since the 80s, but before they were solid. But this, I started making them solid in form, not solid totally. They were coil built, but all the surface is totally enclosed. I start making them with a tunnel in the center. Next, if you go to the next image, you'll see. So when you look through, there's a little, you have a glimpse of light on the other side. So it's almost like looking into a different world. And in many cultures, people go to a tree with a hole in it, and they would speak into the hole and just, kind of just like the lament piece, you're able to express something that you may not be able to say in your regular life, or you may be able to speak to someone in the spirit world or somebody that you don't see. And this was in a show called Women, Surrealism, and Abstraction at the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum of Art in Logan, Utah. And they invited our poets to compose, to select an artwork and compose a poem for it. So this is Navel the Universe that was written by Mary Ellen Greenwood in 2020. So it's on their website, and so you can also look it up there. So this past, I guess, almost two years now, during the pandemic, I start thinking about, well, how do we cope with all this? And I start thinking about how in ancient cultures, in many cultures, people have developed the usage of amulets, talisman, chants, prayers, rituals to help them cope with these kind of events. So I made masks. So I would wear them when I go out. And also I started, I looked at the rocks I have, and I realized how much I like, how much comfort they gave me, just feeling them, holding them. And I think about rocks as, you know, they're so old, they've survived millennium. They've been here on this earth for thousands of years. And so I guess it gives me a sense of resilience, and it gives me a sense of possibility of, you know, rocks can survive this, we can survive this. So I started this series that that deals with using these stones or rocks in these photos. Next, please. So it's a small world, and it goes back to a sculpture I made actually in the 80s. It's also about, it's a small world. So within this little stone is a whole universe. Next. And I start combining the images, the photos that I take with other photos or with drawings. And so they're layered. So I layered, like in this case, I layered images of seaweeds that I took, that I saw on the beach. And to me, they look like our circulatory, they look like blood vessels. Next. So this was one I combined with some drawings and photo. Next. So this was a piece of found wood that I added, painted and added other things to it. Next. And I had an opportunity this summer to work at Anderson Ranch and to be able to use their facility, their 3D printers. So it was learning how to use two new printers, a printer that printed in clay and a printer that printed in plastic. Next. And I was, because of that opportunity, I was able to kind of combine the two, the earthy kind of thick, dense material of clay versus the more ethereal, next please. The more ethereal qualities of the plastic. So this is body and spirit. And sometimes I realize I like the pieces that collapse. To me, they kind of are like a metaphor for our aging body, where our organs collapse. So it's body and spirit. Next. Next. So this is, you know, I guess this is a form that I come back to quite a bit, you know, variations of this form. And next. Next. So, and this is, it leads to that the one before was 3D printed in plastic, and this one is made out of clay. It's in the current show, and it's painted with many, many colors. So again, I kind of layer all the colors on top of each other. So they influenced by looking at tropical fish and a lot of sea life. And Jacques Cousteau was one of my favorite TV program when we lived in New York when I was little. And so I wanted to kind of get a sense of that kind of energy and that kind of sense of celebratory life, that kind of joy that is part of us, that is in our world. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Eva. I'm gonna stop sharing and then we'll have a short bit of time for us to go ahead and reflect on any questions that the audience may have. So go ahead and pop those into the chat. We have a comment from Linda who said, Eva, I so enjoyed having this chance to see an overview of your ideas and work and you've produced over the decades. Barb Moser said, thank you for sharing your work and concepts from over the years, Eva. I genuinely enjoy learning more about your creative journey. Nancy says, wonderful, Eva, thank you. So
thank you.
You're just getting a lot of love here. So I'm gonna ask you a couple of questions.
Okay.
As you are exploring new material, what is it about that material that draws you in? Is it just the opportunity or is it inspiration within the found? Like talk a little bit about how you approach materiality.
Well, I like learning new things. So I oftentimes give myself an assignment to do something new. You know, sometimes they lead to dead ends, but generally they lead to something else, you know. So I always find it valuable, even though it might not be successful right away. Like this 3D printing I've been playing with for the last, I don't know, 5-6 years. Although it's on and off because I don't always have the opportunity. So I may spend 2 weeks a year. Generally, it's about 2 weeks a year. And then there was a period between 2008 and this summer where I didn't work on it at all. You know, so, but this summer, because of the opportunity of going there, you know, I knew that this, what I, they asked me if I wanted to work in the clay studio or something else. And I said, well, I would rather work with your 3D printers. I have interest in it. I'm not very good at it. And, but I want to play with it. So a lot of times, I guess I'm a kind of a curious person and I want to find out things. And the only way to find out something about something is sort of like to jump in. And I think I was very fortunate, I guess, growing up with my grandmother, you know, sometimes can be quite rowdy with 5 kids that are very close in age. So especially summertime when there's no school, we're home all day long, all summer. And so when we start fighting, I mean, there's always somebody to fight with, right? Between 5 kids. So whenever we get rowdy, she'll come in and say, hey, do you want to see how I make a dog? Like sit down around the table and that'll get us to slow down. And we all sit around and she'll grab something. When I was little, I thought it was, she had planned it all. But of course, in hindsight now, as an adult, I realized it was spontaneous because she'll look around like this and grab something. So generally what's easily available, like newspaper. So she'll start folding and making something. And oftentimes, sometimes those things work out, like she'll make a boat, or sometimes she'll start making something and it wouldn't go right. You know, like, well, I try to make a deer, but you know, it doesn't really look like a deer. Well, it's more like a cat. Well, I guess we'll call it a cat, you know, or it would just not work at all. And she'll just say, oh, it didn't work. It's okay. We got to get dinner going. So we'll try again tomorrow. So I think it taught me that it is fine for things to not work out. It taught me, I think, and a tolerance for risk. You know, I see my students being so afraid to try anything. And I said, you know, we don't lose anything by trying, you know, we might lose the opportunity to gain something by not trying. So I guess I have, you know, a great tolerance for risk. So I would try anything, you know, that you put in front of me. And if it doesn't work out, it doesn't kill me, you know. I'm not upset by it because I know it's okay. You know, I think that was probably one of the greatest lessons I learned from my grandmother is that, okay, it didn't work out as a dog. It didn't work out as a deer. It didn't work out as a rat. And she'll like look for other things to like make it into. And then she'll just say, okay, well, it didn't work out. So it's okay. We will try again tomorrow and make it better next time. So I guess, you know, whatever opportunity comes my way, I try to kind of embrace it. I try to kind of, you know, usually first thing is like, oh, what am I going to do? You know, I don't know how to do this. And then, you know, like working at the print shop, because I said, well, I don't know how to make an etching. I've never done it before. So he said, well, we'll show you how to make a plate. I said, okay. And then they show me a few things, you know, how to, you know, run the press. And then he said, then you're on your own. I said, oh, okay. You know, I guess, you know, I'm fine with, the possibility of things not working out. It doesn't scare me, you know. I know some people are really scared by that, but it doesn't scare me because I just think, okay, it's not the end of me. It won't kill me, but I could gain something by learning to do this. And usually I realize that as I'm old, I realize if I work on something long enough, I'll eventually get something out of it. I'll eventually get there. Eventually something will work. Like I said, the 3D printing thing has been, you know, even though it might seem a long time, 5-6 years, but when you add up like a week here or 2 weeks per year, okay, 2 weeks per year, maybe for, let's say, for 4 years or 3 years, that's six weeks, right? And then I have 3 years of not working at all because I had no access to any of the equipment. So I didn't do anything. and then I had 2 weeks this summer. So altogether, it's still like, you know, a couple of months of time, you know, even though it was kind of concentrated time. But you know, I find it exciting to be challenged. I find it exciting to learn new things. I guess that's the whole thing, is to kind of tackle some new territory. I think I would be terribly bored if I did the same thing, or, you know, I got too comfortable. And actually, when I switched from doing the glazing to using the slips in the 80s, like a lot of people would, yeah, I said like, oh, you got so good at that, why do you switch? I said, well, I got too comfortable. You know, I was able to reproduce everything easily. So I felt I kind of reached a certain plateau there, and I need to kind of jump to something else, even though some of the reasoning at that time was health-based, because I didn't want to expose my children, my babies, to all this terrible, to all the chemicals. I didn't know what they would do to them, but I just intuitively feel like I should not, you know, because I would be covered with the stuff when I leave the studio. And, you know, you can't tell a kid not to hug you or kiss you when the minute you walk in the door, that you can't hold them because they're crying because you're full of stuff all over yourself. So I decided to work with something that is cleaner, that it's easier to, that wouldn't get all over me when I paint, which is the slip versus the glaze painting. So some of it was, that was part of the deciding factor for me to move to using a different process of different materials.
Eva, we have a question from Patrick North. Eva, your artistic journey has explored the essence of life and the beginnings and the ends. Where will you go next? And I think this will be our last question, and we'll close out.
Where will I go next in my work? I usually don't know until I get into the studio and work for a while. You know, because sometimes I think you have to kind of surrender yourself to the process. You have to surrender yourself to that studio time. Like when I start working in the, like this summer when I start working in the 3D lab at Anderson Ranch, people ask me, like, do you know exactly what you're going to make? No, I didn't. I mean, I sort of have some faint idea. I would pick up the thread from 3 years ago when I spent 2 weeks working on it. So, but I've forgotten a lot of things. So I had to sort of, but also I was introduced to two new printers that I've never used before, one new program and one old program. So I had to learn a lot of new things. But I think through that learning, you discover things. So I think it's always valuable to put yourself in the situation to learn new things, because then you gain something out of it. You get something out of it. And through the process, new things arrive that I did not anticipate before. I'm not sure if we can go back to the slides, but those little white kind of flower-like things, that's 3D printed. Well, because it's a different kind of filament that I've used before, it's a different printer I've used before, and actually came from a printer fail because we ran out of filament overnight. So when I came back in the morning, the form wasn't completed. It was going to be something like this. It was only like a small portion of it, so it's missing the other part. But I realized I liked the interior so much, and because it's the plastic can be really, really thin, it has this kind of very ethereal, ghost-like kind of quality to it. So it made me think of the spirit world. You know, I think that piece is called Offerings for the Future. And I think about in many cultures, we have shrines. We have shrines to connect us to our ancestors. We have shrines to kind of connect us to our parents or grandparents. And oftentimes we use things from this physical world in the shrine, but we also like burn things like incense and paper, and that smoke, that ethereal smoke, is a conduit from us to the spirit world. So I was thinking, gee, I never thought of plastic this way. You know, for most of my life, I did not like plastic. But then all of a sudden, after seeing that, I realized it has a very special quality that I never imagined. So I learned, you know, it got me thinking about, ooh, those things are kind of, one, they're kind of very ghost-like. They don't seem of this world. They have this very ethereal kind of quality to it that I never imagined before, because I never saw it before. I never experienced it before. I never used that material before. So I could not base my imagination in some ways because I've never been exposed to it. I mean, in some ways, part of imagination has to be based on something we know already. Has to base on some memory plus something else. So, but if we don't have some foundation for it, I think it's hard to make the next jump. But because of all the other things I've seen or done before or experienced before, all the images I've seen, all the things I've seen, all the things I've read about, all the things I've worked with, so it enables me to be able to make this leap. You know, so it's part old stuff and part new stuff, but the old stuff leads us to the new stuff. But I guess it's like putting ourselves in a position to experience new stuff.
Perfect.
I hope that answers.
Yes, I think it answers it in such a way that your curiosity will guide you, and folks better stay tuned because you've got a lot more in you. So thank you so much, Eva. This was really a delight. And thank you to everyone that was able to hang with us. Thank you again for joining us for this artist talk by Eva Kwong as a part of our programming for the 2021 Biennial Juried Exhibition. I'd like to give a special thank you to our jurors, April Tsunami, Jessamy Jones, and Kevin Lyles, as well as to the Ohio Arts Council's board, the Ohio legislature, and the governor who support the OAC, this great space, and of course, Ohio artists. Have a great day, everyone.
Thank you.